My name is Morrie Schwinden, and I was in the United States Army. I currently live in Fargo and have lived here for about the last 65 years. During that era, I was stationed on the island of Okinawa from November of 66 through October of 68. And in that capacity, I was a first lieutenant, and my job was to escort classified documents in and around the island of Okinawa to the different military installations. And then sometimes we would also go off island to such places as the Philippines. I made three trips into Vietnam, went to Hawaii, and minor other stops.
Why don't you tell me about that one trip to Vietnam that you were talking about earlier, and if you could include, I went to Vietnam in the answer.
Mm-hmm. I made three trips into Vietnam. One of was the most memorable was is March of 1968, which was the Tet Offensive. And at that time, we weren't quite aware of what was going on. So the time I spent in the Da Nang Courier Station, I was asked to do another hop up to Phu Bai Way Airport to deliver some classified documents up there, which I and another lieutenant did. We got on our C-130, flew across the ocean, then came across the flatlands, landed in Phu Bai Way, and exchanged information with the military installation there, and then got back on another C-130 and then flew back to Da Nang. While I was there, it was pretty dynamic. There was, at that time, I found out that this was the front line of the Tet Offensive, the biggest offensive by the Viet Cong, and there was artillery flying through the air over the airbase. C-130s were not landing. They were landing, but they weren't stopping. They basically pushed our pallet of material off the runway and just kept going and circled around and went off. The night before, a mortar round had hit an oil depot tank and was spewing out black smoke all over the entire area, and they couldn't put it out because for some reason, either they didn't have the equipment. Also during that time when we were waiting to get on another C-130 to come back to Da Nang, the helicopter started coming in. And I brought my camera along that day, and so I had slides in it and I took pictures. And basically what it was, it's all medical evacuations coming off the front line, and they were stacking them up in three piles, dead, nearly dead, and operable. And if you watch the opening scenes of MASH where they're bringing in the medevacs, it's the same scenario there. And so I took those slides and in the process of trying to relocate them, because obviously they might be of some historical advantage.
But the casualties were quite extensive?
Sure looked like it. I didn't get that close, but we were close enough to take pictures. And there were several receiving medical corps people that were there taking the wounded off the aircraft and stacking them up, and then ambulances were coming and taking them back to the, I suppose it was a MASH unit.
But when you were on this base, was that base being attacked? Was it being shelled? What was happening there?
Well, I couldn't tell. All I could hear was gunfire in the background, and then artillery and mortar rounds flying around the airplanes in the airport. But I didn't actually see any, quote, frontline activity. I could hear it.
Now, the other times you went to Vietnam, was it more quiet?
Yes. The two other times I didn't get off of the Da Nang Air Base. We just delivered our material there and then hopped the next flight back to Okinawa.
So you were on Okinawa, but what were your impressions of Vietnam? What did you expect to see when you said, were told that you were going there?
Well, as all young officers, we had a thrill of enjoyment, not enjoyment, but anticipation of going to the Far East, which I've never been out of North Dakota, Minnesota before this. And it was a thrilling adventure getting to Okinawa to see the other side of the world. Getting to Vietnam, amazingly, when I got there, the people I talked to, routine and boredom was a very big factor there. Unless you're on the front lines and out there running through the rice paddies, it was day after day, same day, no weekends. Everybody was counting the number of days to get to the last day. So it was kind of amazing, I thought.
How did you, were you drafted, were you, did you enlist? How did you get into the service?
I went through NDSU for 4 years, and during that I took the ROTC commission, and I was commissioned a second lieutenant in May of 1966. Then I went on an active duty in November of 66 as a, in the Army, but as a member of the Adjutant General's Corps, which are the paper shufflers of the Army. And from there I was assigned to the Armed Forces Courier System. And there's only about 20 officers a year supplied by the Army to this worldwide network of courier stations all around the world. And one of my more memorable situations was on Okinawa, was the day that the Pueblo was seized off the off of Korea. Okinawa was heavily, heavily armed. There was two air bases, one of which flew out the B-52s, the SR-71s, the 105 fighters, the 10 Phantom 4s, and all kinds of other aircraft. Naha Air Base, a naval base, a major medical installation for Army personnel wounded. Two Marine divisions were headquartered on that island. And the day that the Pueblo was seized, all military-coded machines had to be recoded so they could transmit classified information. Well, I worked 24 straight hours meeting aircraft on and off the flight line and getting those things shipped out back and forth to ships, to air bases, to whatever, and the whole island that night lit up. I mean, it was like a circus. Airplanes were taken off every 2 minutes. All the big installations were on ready alert. Nobody knew what the hell was going on. It was just that we knew that something had happened in the North Korean Peninsula, and all our classified information was compromised.
When you were serving as a lieutenant, second lieutenant, on Okinawa, what did people think about the Vietnam War? I mean, was it generally everyone was for it? Were people concerned about it? What was the feeling on Okinawa?
Amongst the military, was pretty neutral, but the island of Okinawa, the Ryukyu Islanders, protested weekly outside the military gates. They wanted the island to be reverted back to Japan or their own sovereignty, and they also were minorly, I guess, and secondary was that against the Vietnam War. But there was a lot of protests on the island by the natives.
And how were you generally treated? I mean, you went around, you said you delivered information at different parts, probably of the world. I mean, how were you treated when you went to different parts of the world?
No different than any other military personnel. In Vietnam, like I say, everybody was treated the same. There was hardly any distinction between rank, because nobody wanted to wear insignias on their uniforms, because they were targets then. Can't say that at the different ports we came to, the military was so heavily influenced over in the Far East that it went into an island like Okinawa, it was like minor United States. All the air bases and all the Navy installations, they all had basically the modern facilities that we saw in the United States.
So when you left the service, came back to the U.S., did you experience any bad feelings? Did people shout at you or anything? Or?
I had an incident when I was in a bar in Fargo where somebody found out that I was in the military and they called me a baby killer. But in general, although I did have one instance where we were going to go to church on a Sunday morning with my mother, and I told her that should I wear my uniform, because I was on emergency leave for my father's illness. And I asked her, should I wear my military uniform to church? And she said, oh, no, don't do that. People around here have been hearing a lot of news about the Vietnam and all the protests and related items like that. So she recommended I not, and I did not.
Have you talked, I know, once again, you're mostly headquartered in Okinawa, but have you talked about your experiences in the military much since you've been out of the military?
Oh yes, yeah, we talk about it all the time. I have two very close friends. We graduated together. We're in each other's weddings and We're godparents to their children, our children, whatever. And we meet twice a year and discuss about the days in Vietnam. Both of those people were stationed in Vietnam for their 13-month tour of duty, where I was only TDY, meaning temporary duty. But we talk very freely about things.
What did they talk about? What happened to them that over there?
One was in the Transportation Corps, and he was doing a convoy going through someplace, and they hit some kind of a mine, and the jeep he was in rolled over, and he hurt his foot. And so that was a memorable experience for him, and I assume he's still in disability because of that. The other one was in the Ordnance Corps. He talks about different things, but just general nature.
What are your feelings in retrospect about Vietnam when you think about the war there and how it might have affected the U.S.? What's your feelings about that?
Well, when I was in the campaign, obviously I was taught the military philosophy, shall we say. But after I got back and started reading what was happening there and some of the political things that were going on, to me it was one big wasted experiment by the military and the politicians that they brainwashed. There was nothing accomplished there. We lost, 50,000 troops, two of them which were my personal friends through ROTC. On Okinawa, we used to see the medevacs come in, the Marines, and they were sent back to Okinawa for rehabbing before they went to the States. And you see these guys shot up, mangled, and for what? And interesting enough, about 10 or 15 years after the war, I turned on the news one night, on the national news, and on that sequence was a clip of Secretary of State McNamara shaking hands with the Prime Minister of North Vietnam. And basically what they said and agreed to, that the Gulf of Tonkin never happened. So here we have our fearless leaders telling us that we were brainwashed into this war by a fictitious event. Now I hope this comes out in Ken Burns' episodes, because to me that put the stamp of one big wasted experiment.
Anything else you'd like to share? That was pretty definitive there.
Very much so. Another thing is I just found out on watching Prairie Public TV the other night about the Johnson and the Nixon thing, is that during the course of Johnson's administration, there was a time when he could have ended the war, but Nixon stepped in and interfered with it and harpooned his efforts to do that because he didn't want to have Johnson get credit for stopping the Vietnam War. And the war lasted for another year, in which there was another 10,000 casualties. Politics. And here we are, stranded in another war, the longest in our history, same outcome, same scenario, same everything, but we're footing the bill.
Yeah, that was Nixon and Kissinger.
That could have been it, yeah.
Yeah, so, and Daryl Dorgan, who's a friend of mine, was telling me he had read a bunch of the documents that had just recently been released.
That's what it was, yep.
And yeah, just that basically for campaign reasons, they sabotaged it.
Yep. Also,
what you got there?
This is an email that I received from a friend, and basically it says that the 105 pilots that were flying over North Vietnam, they were flying in restricted areas where they could only fly in certain flight paths. And according to this email, the Swiss embassy was notified by the United States government to contact the North Vietnam people of when these attacks were coming. So that way the factories and anything else that they bombed wouldn't have collateral damage of civilians. But at the same token, then the North Vietnam people could set up the barrage of artillery to try shoot down these 105s. In another case, and I've heard this from many Marines that came out of Nam, is we went into Vietnam fighting with one arm tied behind our back. And the Marines were just basically hard-nosed fighters And as they would tell us, they'd go in and take out a valley 1 week, retreat, and have to retake it back another month later. All for what?